Joseph Meyer. Many instances of angels saying these words. An angel came to Paul in jail and said, "Rise quickly." And another angel says to Gideon, "Arise and go in this thy might." And an angel says to Elijah, "Arise and eat." Then there's the angel who appears to Joseph in a dream and says, "Go quickly to escape Herod." An angel appears to Philip and says, "Arise and go." On these passages, angel voices seem dull and monotonous, more like an alarm clock than the appearance of a divine being. When the angel approached Zechariah to announce that his wife Elizabeth will bear a son, the angel tells him, "Do not be afraid." And when the angel Gabriel comes to Mary, and announces that she will be the mother of the long-awaited Messiah, she says that he says that she has found favor with God. In both of these angel encounters, the people addressed by the angels were urged to remain calm and allow God to work in their lives. These are the messengers from God that we like to hear, because they announce God's plans save the world, So welcome to worship in the Port Iron United Methodist Church on this fourth Sunday in Advent, as we listen for the voices of the angels while celebrating the gift of his Messiah, the incarnate Son of God. The verse I want to bring to your attention this morning is Luke chapter 1, verse 37. The angel said to Mary, "For nothing will be impossible with God."
Lord, do they? Thanks and praise we give.
Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From hence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Come to us, promised one, in this season of waiting. Set our hearts ablaze with the glory of your salvation. Set our minds aflame with the richness of your word. Reveal to us the secret of your ways. For you alone are wise. You alone are worthy of our thanks and praise. Through Jesus Christ our Lord we pray. Amen. And our next hymn is number 234 in the hymnal, O Come Holy Faithful. Page 199 in the hymnal. I'll read the regular text and would ask you to respond with the bold text. I think it might be in bold too, isn't it? Okay. My soul magnifies the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God my Savior, who has looked with favor on the loneliness of her servant. From this day, all generations will call me blessed.
The Mighty
One has done great things for me, and holy is the name of the Lord, whose mercy is for those who fear God from generation to generation. The arm of the Lord is strong, and has scattered the proud in their conceit. God has cast down the mighty from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. God has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. God has come to the aid of Israel, the chosen servant, remembering the promise of mercy, the promise he made to our forebears, to Abraham and his children forever.
This morning's Old Testament lesson is 2 Samuel chapter 7. Verses 1 through 11 and 16. Now when the king was settled in his house, and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies around him, the king said to the prophet Nathan, "See now, I'm living in a house of cedar, but the ark of the God stays in a tent." Nathan said to the king, "Go do all that you have in mind, for the Lord is with you." But that same night, the word of the Lord came to Nathan, "Go and tell my servant David, thus says the Lord, you are the one to build, are you the one to build me a house to live in? I have not lived in a house since the day I brought up the people of Israel from Egypt to this day, but I have been moving about in a tent and a tabernacle. Wherever I have moved about among all the peoples of Israel, did I ever speak a word with any of the tribal leaders of Israel whom I commanded to shepherd my people, Israel, saying, 'Why have you not built me a house of cedar?' Now therefore, thus you shall say to my servant David, thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the pasture, from following the sheep, to be prince over my people Israel. And I have been with you wherever you went, and have cut off all your enemies from before you. And I will make for you a great name, like the name of the great ones of the earth. And I will appoint a place for my people Israel, and will plant them, so that they may live in their own place and be disturbed no more. And evildoers shall afflict them no more, as formerly from the time that I appointed judges over my people Israel. And I will give you rest from all your enemies. Moreover, the Lord declares to you that the Lord will make you a house. Your house and your kingdom shall be made sure forever before me. Your throne shall be established forever." And this morning's epistle lesson is Romans chapter 16, verses 25 to 27. "Now to God, who is able to strengthen you according to my gospel and the proclamation of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery that was kept secret for long years, but is now disclosed and through prophetic writings is made known to all the Gentiles, according to the command of the eternal God, to bring about the obedience of faith to the only wise God, through Christ Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever. Amen." And this morning's gospel is Luke chapter 1, verses 26 to 38. "In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, 'Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you.' She was much perplexed by his words, and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, 'Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great, and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give him to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I'm a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her, who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. There's just something wonderful about angels appearing to people. According to Steve Shirley, angels appear 18 times in the New Testament. I'm not sure what makes Steve an authority, but apparently he's done his research. The angels make several appearances in the birth narratives in both in the Gospels. In Luke's Gospel, the first angel appearance is to Zechariah in Luke chapter 1, verses 11 through 20. And then the angel Gabriel appears to Mary in the verses that we read this morning. And finally, a heavenly host of angels appeared to the shepherds on the mountainside in chapter 2. There are also angels in Matthew's Gospel. They appear 3 times in his birth story. And each of those appearances is to Joseph. Matthew 20, or chapter 1, 20 through 24, chapter 2, 13 through 50, and 19 through 20. So that leaves 12 more appearances in the New Testament. Twice the angels appear to Jesus. The first time is reported twice, once by Matthew in chapter 4 and again by Mark in chapter 1, and that includes the angels appearing to Jesus after he's been tempted in the desert and ministering to him. And the second time the angels appear is in Luke chapter 22, verse 43, as Jesus prays on the Mount of Olives. All of the other appearances are to the apostles and other followers of Jesus after his death and resurrection. Now, only 2 angels are ever named in all of the Bible: Gabriel, the one we'll talk about today, and Michael, who made an appearance in the Old Testament book of Daniel. want to direct your attention to the angel Gabriel in our gospel reading this morning. He appears to Mary with the news that she is the woman chosen by God to bear his immaculately conceived son. Her first response, of course, is one of doubt. How could this be, since I'm a virgin? She says in verse 38. Even after the angel explains how this conception will be divine, Mary was perhaps both excited and concerned. The news was exciting because she's given a part to do to work with God. But the concerning part was how would she handle her betrothal to Joseph? What's she going to do? How's she going to tell him? Can she confide in her mother? So the scriptures don't mention anything about Mary's family. No mention of a father or a mother, or sisters and brothers. The only person she can turn to is her relative Elizabeth, who the angel had said was also miraculously pregnant in her old age. So Mary makes that 80 to 90 mile journey from her home to Ein Garim, where Elizabeth and her husband Zachariah lived. That same Zachariah who had an earlier encounter with an unnamed angel. That angel's message for him was that his wife Elizabeth would bear the very son that Mary is going to visit. She probably traveled with a caravan that was passing through Nazareth on its way to Jerusalem, which is just north of Ein Garim. You see, in those days, unmarried teenage women, and surely Mary is no older than a teenager, would never make that 8 to 10 day journey from Nazareth through Samaria to Jerusalem alone. So it seems likely that Mary joined this caravan, a caravan, to make the trip. So when she gets to their home, she greets Elizabeth, who is by now in the later stages of her pregnancy, just like the angel Gabriel told her she would be. We don't know how long Mary stayed with Elizabeth. She may have stayed long enough to help her deliver her child, John the Baptist. Through Luke's gospel, the author emphasizes throughout Luke's gospel, he emphasizes the role of women in Jesus' ministry. And specifically in verses 39 through 45, where Mary and Elizabeth are given a lot of extra attention. In verse 43, Elizabeth makes the first and only Christological confession by a woman in all of Luke's gospel. Why has this happened to me, that the mother of my Lord comes to me? In Luke, Lord is the Christian title for Jesus, affirming his divine nature. So Elizabeth's response to the presence of the pregnant Mary and her unborn child is one of a prophetic nature, as shown by Luke. So Elizabeth is a special woman. She is a descendant of the line of the first Levite priest, Aaron, and is described as upright and divine, devout, blamelessly observing all the commandments and the ordinances. She is named and referred to by name 9 times in Luke's gospel. 4 times in the text described her own difficulty conceiving and bearing children. And once she's talked about by the angel Gabriel to Mary. and another four times in Luke 39 through 45. It seems like Elizabeth is just the person that Mary needs to help her through this challenging phase of her pregnancy. The narrative between these two women is the only section in the gospel in which women are given speeches that are not followed by them being corrected. These are powerful voices for women doing what is required of them to fulfill God's plan for their lives and for the rest of the world. So Mary went to Elizabeth as a confused and frightened and alone teenager. She found in her a mentor with whom she could confide about her own condition, and she gained insight into what was going to happen to her as the pregnancy progressed. And Mary responds to Elizabeth with her own prophetic voice. In Luke chapter 1, verses 46b through 55. Luke attributes these words of the words of the Magnificat to her, giving her a voice that is as powerful as the voice of Elizabeth. The Magnificat is Mary's prayer of thanksgiving for the blessings God has passed on to her. It contains many of the themes emphasized throughout Luke's gospel, particularly God's concern for the lonely, the hungry, and the disadvantaged, and God's judgment upon the self-indulgent. John Wesley considers Mary to be among the prophets by noting that she spoke under a prophetic impulse. And throughout his writings, Luke depicts Mary as a female Bible believer, almost, but not quite, labeling her as a prophet or a disciple. Mary is the only woman Luke has given a full speech of proclamation. Let's get back to the angels. Adam Hamilton, in his book, The Journey, tells his readers that angels may come to people in a form of everyday people, like Elizabeth, who was inspired by God. They bring divine words spoken in conversations with others who need to hear God's voice. Angels shaped the lives of Zechariah, Mary, and the shepherds on those hillside. Mary's encounter with Elizabeth seems angelic, but Elizabeth is more than an angel. She's a prophet, like the prophet Nathan, who spoke to Samuel in our Old Testament. She's also Mary's friend, confident and teacher, who gave her the strength and the faith to go forward with God's plan in spite of her uncertainty. As we prepare to celebrate the birth of Jesus, consider how our words might shape the lives of others that we meet. Do we speak like angels, giving glory to God while shouting good news? Or do our voices comfort, teach, and encourage others as they journey through life? Could we be someone else's Elizabeth, encouraging and proclaiming glory when God is near? Or maybe the shoe's on the other foot. Some of us may be in Mary's place in need of encouragement from the divine. If that's you, stop. Be quiet and listen carefully for the voices of angels and or the Elizabeths who are all around us. Sometimes in everyday encounters with others, we will find that inspiration from God that hits closest to home. Zechariah, Mary, Joseph, the shepherds, and even the wise men who followed the star are inspired by God as they travel around Nazareth, Ein Kerem, Jerusalem, and Bethlehem all those years ago. God is the important part of the story. And yet, unless we listen carefully, we might miss the voice of the angels giving glory to him. Amen. God, we confess we are not the people you hold us to be. The very ones you favor, we too often ignore or ridicule. The ones who knock off their pedestal, we admire and emulate. We are focused on having more and more. We risk being sent away. Forgive us, mighty God, and look with grace upon us. We would live secure in your love. We would be the ones of peace for our hope. We would seek to do your will, as did Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, in whose name we pray. Amen. Would you continue with me in an attitude of prayer this morning? Lord God, you've called us, each of us, to loose the bounds of injustice and to let the oppressed go free, to break every yoke. You've called us to share our bread with the hungry, to bring the homeless poor into our homes and to cover the naked. Lord, we have offered you those we have named in our prayer list this morning. Include them in the light of your love. Strengthen all for whatever circumstances they face. Guide and direct us as your servants to bring your love and light to everyone we meet, so that we might know your love, they might know your love for all people. We pause now for a few moments of silent prayer to bring our private petitions directly to God's ears. Almighty God, in the words of Mary's Magnificat, may we magnify the Lord who calls us to do these things, and may we do them joyfully and thankfully. We pray this prayer in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And our last hymn this morning is number 2098 in the Faith We Sing, The Virgin Mary Had a Baby Boy.
Thank you.
go forth, glorifying God with hearts full of joy. Praise God with lips filled with laughter. Bless the world with mercy and grace that you have received from God. Grow in the fullness of God's blessing. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen.